It's finding it. It's not talking to her. That's weird.
It did yesterday.
Yeah, I know. Bummer. I just have it all held up. Oh, you just want to go? Oh, okay.
Good morning, Christchurch family, and welcome. I'm Pastor Jenny Morrison, and also welcome to our visitors online. I am very grateful today to have Ashley Deering, who is our admin, to help film today, so thank you for that. I welcome you with the love and peace of Christ. I'm assuming you can hear me all right. Please put in the notes there if you cannot. We're trying some different sound things today, and this, again, is a gradual process of figuring out what tech works best, so thank you for your grace. At first, as we are all aware, we've been given the green light to slowly reopen Minnesota as we know it, but again, we as a church will be careful in how that's done. The bishop still insists we wait until after May 30th to gather together, and even then with 10 or fewer, and then it'll be gradual. So I continue to work with the Ad Council to figure out the best plan, and we'll certainly keep you all posted as to how this will unfold. So thank you for your consistent commitment and involvement with our small but mighty church. Are we secure?
Sound not good, is what they're saying.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So we'll try with this and see if this helps. Be sure and let us know. Hopefully this is better. As a piece of good news, I'm happy to announce that one of our members, Kat Weller, and her partner Ashley were recently married in a civil ceremony this last week. And they wanted me to be sure to tell you that there still be a big wedding and party next year, and that all are invited. So we celebrate them and their union, and we'll rejoice with them with a big party next year. So keep that on your radar and continue to send them love and blessings. A special thanks to our finance team and our treasurer, Terry DeGraw, in particular, for his hard work regarding our monies. We actually did well in April, so let's keep that going, and still work to be done, even though it's virtual. There's a lot of detail that goes into this. So, also next Sunday, May 24th, Memorial Day weekend, my brother and I will be taking a break, but I'll be posting another service or a pre-recorded musical event, so stay tuned for that. And then lastly, if there's something you want announced or for us to share, please email me or call the office and talk to Ash, and we'll take care of that for you. And so with that said, let us prepare our hearts for worship with our call to worship and confession.
Say it's okay, I'm not
Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us through groans that words cannot express.
And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for us in accordance with the will of God.
Savior Jesus, in your mercy, by your holy life that heals us, by your holy death that saves us, by your Holy Spirit with us, come to cleanse these sinners that we are. Set us free to obey you and make us clear to stand before you. Then, for your mercy, we will praise you. Amen. Hear the good news. Who is in a position to condemn? Only Christ, and Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. Christ prays for us. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life has gone. The new life has begun. Know that you are forgiven and be at peace. Thanks be to God. And now we'll sing Leaning on the Everlasting Arms in our Methodist Hymnal 133. We'll see if this helps, folks. Sound is better this way, okay? Again, we're just trying to learn as we go here, figure out the best possible layout. So, let us rejoice. Hey, George, get your hymnal open. If you're going to be here, you got to participate.
What a blessing.
doesn't sound not good.
Okay.
Oh, that's an old one.
And now Miss Maya will read.
Proverbs 3:5. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding. Romans 5:3-5. There's more to come. We continue to shout our praise even when we're hemmed with troubles, because we know how troubles can develop passionate patience in us, and how that patience in turn forges the tempered steel of virtue, keeping us alert for whatever God will do next. In alert expectancy such as this, we're never left feeling shortchanged. Quite the contrary, we can't round up enough containers to hold everything God generously pours in our lives through the Holy Spirit, the Word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Well, one of those days, right? Where everything is kind of funky. So hopefully you can hear me now. Can folks, before I start, I want to see if folks can hear me. Can you hear me? If someone would please respond in the box, that would be great. Hello, hello, hello. Are you able to hear me? Okay. All right, I'm gonna just go on through, okay? Isn't it the sign of times we're in? So now what? Now what? We look at each other like deer in the headlights and pronounce, now what? Following the big pronouncement from Governor Waltz this past week and even our bishop, we heard the sound of clanking keys and maybe a few gates opening up. We were told we could gently, gradually return to life as we know it. And of course, as we read, some people went off the deep end, and we'll see the result of that in the days ahead. Obviously, with certain restrictions and an emphasis on those smart practices continue, washing hands, social distancing, and wearing masks. We were shown some light at the end of the tunnel, especially when we heard the restaurants and salons will be opening June 1. Woohoo! Right? First world problems, I know, but I know many are happy. And yet, of course, it doesn't necessarily bring relief. It brought a mix of emotions for many of us. There are still so many unknowns. This reopening casts some needed hope on a situation that started out as uncharted territory, maybe even a novelty for a while, providing quality family time, getting to sup together again, but which for these past 7-8 weeks have become very isolated, for some mentally exhausting and dim. I've mentioned before, and this has been very hard for me, not getting to see family or friends face to face, albeit my wonderful nieces and my brother here, I'm so grateful for that. But not getting to see any of you in person either has been difficult. Albeit we're grateful for FaceTime and Zoom, it's still not my best case scenario. But yay technology, except for today. I am thankful that it has given many of us the opportunity to keep in touch and grounded in something fruitful, those important relationships. Perhaps not what we prefer, but next best thing, right? It provides a little bit of connectivity. In the Romans text that Maya read,
just a bit earlier, and I use the Message version for that, as I think it's very accessible for all people, especially young people. I'm going to look into the NRSV in this particular translation in reference to how this text gives us hope and an answer for that, what now? Not only this, but we also rejoice in our sufferings, is that first line, verse 3. Oh my, who gets a little ruffled when they hear that? I do sometimes. No one wants to suffer. And we are not a culture who likes to be uncomfortable either, as this pandemic will attest. But in his second letter to the Church of Corinth, Paul boasted of his sufferings, which demonstrated the selfless quality of his ministry. He was awaiting trial, imprisoned in a rat-infested pit. So how can a person boast about suffering? I don't believe that Paul was a masochist, so in as such, he's not suggesting that we should solicit suffering or find pleasure in it, to be martyrs. His counsel is instead rooted in his faith that God transforms Good Fridays into Easters. Amen?
Amen.
And that God embeds a blessing in every hardship for those who trust him. Truth. Truth, people. I've experienced it. I've called out to God when I've been struggling, and God has answered. Now, maybe not in the way I would expect, but God shows up. Whether it's a phone call from a friend or a check-in from a neighbor, God has responded just in time. Now as we look at the second part of verse 3:3b, knowing that suffering works perseverance. In this section, Paul outlines the blessings that come through suffering. I like to say stretching or growing. Just like an elite athlete, it takes hard work to reach that ultimate goal, or as John Wesley would say, perfection. This then means being uncomfortable sometimes, right? Therefore, suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us. Verse 4, perseverance, proven character, and proven character brings hope. Dokimen, which is Greek, has to do with testing. So Paul is saying that endurance produces a tested or a proven character, the solid character of a veteran rather than the uncertain character of a recruit, or I like to say, rookie. This then produces hope, because the veteran, having triumphed over adversity in the past, can hope to triumph over adversity in the future. It's that, been there, done that. I can do this too. And finally, in verse 5, and hope doesn't disappoint us, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who was given to us. No matter what happens, God loves us. We are beloved sons and daughters, people whom God will never abandon. God provides for the birds of the air and the lilies of the field, so we can be sure that God will provide for us. Amen? As an amateur history buff and the daughter of a history expert, so he said, this made me curious about the flu pandemic of 1918, where it was estimated that over 50 million people died worldwide. More than 100 years ago, Minnesotans contended with this deadly virus for which there was no effective treatment, and which was misnamed the Spanish flu. The influenza reached here just as World War I was coming to an end, considered the worst public health catastrophe since the bubonic plague of the 13th century. The influenza moved swiftly throughout this country, killing more than 500,000 Americans, nearly 10 times the number of battlefield deaths suffered by U.S. troops during World War I. As a September 28, 1918, Minnesota physician Dr. H.M. Bracken noted the rapid spread of the disease in a brief but disturbing telegram to his colleagues at the Minnesota Board of Health. Quote, severe influenza, Faribault County, Wells Village. 100 cases reported following return of soldier from containment. Unquote. For you see, much of the flu was brought back from these young men who had been serving in the war. Bracken's telegram was the first report that the worldwide epidemic had finally reached Minnesota. The surging epidemic put a huge strain on the state's medical personnel, particularly now that many health workers were away from home serving in the military. The U.S. Surgeon General began running ads in the local papers in an effort to recruit more nurses. One ad in the Minneapolis Journal entitled, "The Nation Needs Nurses to Check Influenza," stated that owing to rapid spread of the present epidemic, the safety of this country demands that all patriotic nurses, nurses' aides, or anyone with experience in nursing place themselves at once at the disposal of the government. There were eventually bans on public gatherings and bars, churches, theaters, and dance halls. Sound familiar? With the state health officials predicting that the epidemic would soon crest and then burn itself out. By mid-November, that year's influenza wave in Minnesota did start subsiding, as was predicted. And as we know, although sadly lives were lost, many survived and managed to thrive in the years that followed. Rather ironic, isn't it? Throughout history, from the beginning of recorded time, we've read or experienced wars, plagues, pestilence, epidemics, pandemics, you name it. And this is not to avoid the severity of our current situation, but it does show us that this is not the first time something like this has happened. Yet, in as such, here's our piece of joy. However terrible things have been, human beings have found a way to get through, to push through the adversity. Yes, there is grief and loss, and we are allowed and encouraged to lament those losses. There's a book in the Bible called Lamentations, for just such a time as this. For God knows there is a time of pain and suffering. Even so, somehow, some way, we're finding a way to stand up and keep going. We're enduring, we're persevering. And for many, including myself, we find that way through our faith in God. And it is in Paul's words of perseverance that I am hopeful and I'm given energy. And as I have grieved during these weeks, as I know many of you have as well, it is in that lamenting that I've also been awakened to so many blessings. In fact, I am being very intentional these days about writing down and professing out loud all the things I am grateful for, because there is so much. Plus, I just get tired of hearing myself whine. But seriously, it is by our faith walk, by trusting in something greater than ourselves, that we find renewal, strength, and hope. So I ask you again, now what? Now what? Now we continue to push through with open minds and hearts to whatever it is God asks of us to hear and or do, taking it one day at a time, because folks, that's all we have. We are not in control. And we lean into this episode in history safely and wisely, yet we do not run away in fear. That is not God. So, let us lean on and into God. the good news. As it says in the final verse of those Romans texts, keeping us alert for whatever God will do next. In alert expectancy such as this, we're never left feeling short-changed. Quite the contrary. We can't round up enough containers to hold everything God generously pours into our lives through the Holy Spirit. Yes, be ready for the blessings. Be ready for the blessings. May it be so for you and all people everywhere. Amen and amen. And now it's time for prayer. Let us be in an attitude of prayer. Creator God, we come before you this day, grateful that we woke up this morning, grateful for our family and friends, for those of us who have good health, we thank you. We pray for those who are struggling, whether it be with COVID-19, cancer, whatever it might be. Put your healing touch upon them now, Creator God. And may they find ultimate healing through you. Creator God, pray for all those on the front lines, in the medical profession, the first responders, and once again, all of those people that are working jobs that we take for granted, whether it be Target, in a gas station, the semi drivers, we thank you for them. And now as this time appears to be evolving into opening up and something different, maybe still be wise, but not panic about it. That we will be okay. Mm-hmm. us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. And now receive the blessing, if you can hear it. Go in peace, serve the living God, being a light that shines so bright, no one can deny the love of our mighty God. Amen.